Hello viewer, welcome to another show of the Science Hub. My name is Trevor Kanogu.
And I'm John Kamau.
And as always, I am Severino Koth.
And we will teach you Physics Form 3, a topic known as Work, Energy, Power, and Machines. So, let's begin with energy. What are some of the sources of energy? We have natural sources like the sun, wind, geothermal, fuels.
We also have high dams. Oh, that is geothermal. We also have ocean, and which provide wave energy.
So let us go to the types of energy. There's non-renewable energy and non-renewable energy. John?
So, renewable energy, sun. These are the types of energy that cannot be exhausted, but non-renewable can be exhausted. For example, petroleum. That's why when you're driving your car, you get to a point, you stop abruptly.
Yeah, so there are also different forms of energy. Let's name them.
We have chemical energy,
mechanical energy,
potential energy,
heat energy,
and wave energy.
Yeah, so let's go ahead and let us now deal with work and energy. What is work?
Work, this is the... Okay, to the layman's language, work is defined as, what can you say?
The job that you do.
The job that you do and what makes you feel tired. But in the physics man's language, work is...
Force times distance.
And this is the amount of force applied and the distance covered as you apply that force, isn't it?
Yes. And, and energy is the ability to do
work.
Work. So how is work calculated?
You say that work is equals to
force times distance.
Force is measured in
newtons.
And distance is measured in
meters.
So work is
the unit is newton meter. And 1 newton meter is equals to 1 joule. So you can say that 1 newton meter is 1 joule. Yes.
So on to the law of conservation of energy. You know, when in a system, energy is neither destroyed or nor is it created,
yes.
But it just changes from one medium to another.
Not from one form to another, yes.
Like for example, in a pendulum, when you release a pendulum from a high point, at that point it has potential energy. But as it's moving, it gains momentum and gains kinetic energy. From that we see that energy is not created, nor is it destroyed, but it's just being converted from one form to another.
As Trevor is illustrating on the board.
Yes.
So when the pendulum is here, its speed is at zero. So it has potential energy. And potential energy is the amount of work done by an object while it's stationary, which is calculated as the mass, the singularity, and the height. And we have kinetic energy. This is the energy of a moving object. And also when it's here, it has zero velocity, so potential energy.
So kinetic energy is calculated by the half. Mg. So in this system, mgh is equals to half mv squared. So on to power. What's power?
Power, this is described as the rate of doing work.
It can also be described as the rate of change of conversion of energy. Okay, so you can say that power, we can go on and say that power equals to work done over energy.
Yes.
So power equals to work done is the same thing.
Yes, and power is measured in the unit watt. Yes. 1 watt.
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Not watt, it is 1 watt.
Okay, so let us go to machines. A machine is a device that enables you to do a work easier, or devices that make work
easier.
Yeah,
so there are some important terms that you need to know and associate them with machines. The first term is effort. Effort, this is the force applied to overcome to the machine in order to do some work, isn't it?
Yes.
And we also have load, which is the force exerted by the effort that you put into the machine.
Okay. So when you go and relate load and effort, you get a ratio. This ratio is referred to as mechanical advantage. So mechanical advantage is the ratio of load and effort. So mechanical advantage equals to whichever load over effort.
And this load and effort are both in newtons, isn't
yes.
it? Which means it has no
units. Next, on to our next terminology, which have the velocity ratio. Velocity ratio simply means is the ratio between the distance moved by the effort and the distance moved by the load. So if the load moves a distance of 1 meter and the effort moves a distance of 1.5 meter, the velocity ratio is 1.5. That's the velocity ratio.
We also have efficiency. Efficiency, this is a form of, it's a percentage whereby you get efficiency by the load multiplied by the distance moved by the load over the effort moved, multiplied by the distance moved by the effort times 100 to get it in percentage.
So in simple terms, the efficiency is a work output over the work input multiplied by 100. And remember that efficiency is always expressed in percentage form. That's why we have 100%.
We got it as mechanical advantage of velocity ratio because, as you can see, it is load times distance moved by. Efficiency is expressed as load multiplied by the distance moved by the load over effort multiplied by the distance moved by the effort. As you can see here, this one here is expressed as mechanical advantage, isn't it? Yes. So it is mechanical advantage. And from this one, you can see that it is the distance moved by the load over the distance covered by the effort. But as we talked earlier, we talk about velocity ratio. Velocity ratio was the distance covered by the effort over the distance covered by the load. As you can see, this here is the inverse of this, isn't it? So in short, this expression can be simplified to mechanical advantage multiplied by the inverse of velocity ratio. So it has been simplified by Trevor to this, which was mechanical advantage over velocity ratio times 100, not 50%.
So after knowing those terminology, we'll move to the types of machines. And Trevor, we'll start with the lever.
Yeah, so what is a lever? A lever is a machine that uses the simple principle of moments. When you put the effort here, the load goes up. So simply, to get the velocity ratio in a lever, you'll use the same formula that we gave you, which is the distance. Okay, so this is an example of a lever. We have the effort that comes, okay, let this be the load, and then we have the effort. So this distance that was, imagine, before anything was added, it was this way. So this distance moved by the effort over the distance moved by the load. Over the load distance will be equals to the velocity ratio.
So on to our second machine, which is the wheel and axle.
Before we go to the second machine, I'd like to say that in the levers, there are three different classes of levers, aren't there? There's the first class lever where the fulcrum is between the effort and the load, isn't it? What's the second one?
Okay, in the second levers, the second class levers, we know that the levers with the load between the pivot and the effort.
An example is a wheelbarrow.
So you can simplify all this by saying this is an acronym, FLEG. So this means fulcrum, load, and effort. So for first class levers, the fulcrum is always in the middle of the effort and the load. For second class levers, the load is always in the middle of the effort and the fulcrum. And the same applies for the third class level, where the effort is always between the load and fulcrum.
Yes. We move on to another machine known as the wheel.
So our next machine is the wheel and axle. So this is the wheel. This is the axle. So that's where our effort is applied. And this is where the load is at. So let's take the radius of this wheel to be R, capital R, and the radius of this to be R. Okay, so the distance moved, when you pull it, the distance moved is the circumference of the axle, which is 2 pi R. And the distance moved with this one is pulled is 2 pi R. Okay.
Yes.
And velocity ratio equals to?
Distance moved with the effort, and the distance covered with the load.
Yeah. Effort distance is?
2 pi r.
So you can cancel this, and from the foregoing, you can reduce that. Velocity ratio of the wheel and axle equals to?
Yeah.
So our next machine is the inclined plane. So the inclined plane is used mostly as a ramp. For example, you have a height here and you need to pull and you need to push this load up this inclined plane to this particular point, isn't it? So this is the distance the load will move, isn't it? But the actual height that it will cover will be this. And take this angle to be theta, isn't it? So, from mathematics, sine theta equals to opposite to the hypotenuse. Isn't it? So, from here, opposite is the height. Right? And the hypotenuse is sine theta, isn't it? And so,
to get h. So to get h, there's the height from here to here. We play around with this to make it the formula. So we multiply this side by the length, cancel it out, and also multiply this other side by the length. So this hypotenuse, the height I mean, is equal to the length, the load distance covered from here to here, multiplied by the sine of the angle made at this point. So we get h equals to l sine of theta. So the velocity ratio of my machine is given by the distance covered by the effort divided by the distance covered by the load. So the distance covered by the effort is this one from here to here. This equals to l. And the distance covered by the load is the height, which is given by l sine theta.
And from the foregoing, you can see that since we have L up here and L down here, we can cancel out so that you have 1 theta and 2 theta. Such that if this angle theta was 0.5, then the L was 30 degrees, the velocity ratio will be 1 over 30 degrees.
Yes. Sine 30 degrees.
Over sine 30. Yeah. So, somebody, what's our next machine?
Our next machine is the pulley. The pulley is a machine that is used to pull things up. Trevor, can you elaborate on this?
So, a pulley is such kind of a machine. Like, you have a load, you are here, you put your effort. So, the pulley works this way. When you Okay, so when you pull the effort downwards, the load goes upwards. So we know that velocity ratio is equal to effort distance over load distance. And how do you get the effort distance? This is half the perimeter energy. So how do you get half the perimeter? It goes to half times pi d over. How do you get the load distance? The load distance is, of course, the distance that you would by this object upwards. Yeah, it is also half.
So, from the foregoing, you can see that the velocity ratio is 1, yeah. Since we all can't allow.
Yeah. So, what if there are three pulleys?
So the first pulley Trevor drew was the single fixed pulley. And we have three types of pulleys. We have a single fixed pulley, the single movable pulley, and lock and tap system. So the single fixed pulley was on the chamber group. And then this. That's the one. That's the one. So here the velocity ratio is 1.
Yes.
That's a single fixed pulley. Okay. Then we also have the single movement pulley. So,
let me do this one. This is a point, let's say a high point. So this pulley is in such a manner that it is pulled from above. And from the bottom here is where you are loading the cart, isn't it? You can never calculate the velocity ratio of this pulley.
Okay, so we know that the mechanical advantage of this pulley will be found by the labor and the effort. So how will we calculate this?
We find that
the velocity ratio of a single movable pulley is that the number of ropes supporting the load are
2.
So if and the effort in one string is equal to the effort in the other, therefore we know that L, which is the load, will be equal to double the effort. Which will be equal to double the effort. So we know that the mechanical advantage will be equal to 2E over E. Therefore the mechanical advantage will be 2E2. So what about the block and tackle system?
Also the block and tackle system is a type of, is a special type of pulley which contains one set of movable pulleys and the other of fixed pulleys. So it's something like this. So this is your point of attachment. Then you have the fixed pulley here. So from here I can have two. Let me handle this out a bit. Then we can have the movable pulleys. Okay. So this we draw it.
Yeah, so we have the block and tackle pulley system, we begin to it. From the bottom here, this is where you're going to attach your effort, isn't it? Your load, I mean. So from here, we pull it, we apply our effort here in order to pull this load up. I hope that you have observed, in order to know the velocity ratio of a pulley, we count the number of strings that are holding up the load, isn't it? So from here, we can see that the number of strings holding up this load are 1, 2, 3, and 4. We do not count this one because this one is where the effort is applied from, isn't it? So we can deduce that from that, 1, 2, 3, 4, the velocity ratio of this pulley is 4.
Yes. Okay. So from that, we can see that machines help in making our work easier. And remember, we've learned velocity ratio, mechanical advantage, efficiency, effort, load, energy, process of energy. Please remember that.
Yeah.
Okay, we have come to the end of our discussion. It has been Science Hub. So my name is Trevor Kanogo.
My name is Severin Okoth.
And I'm John Kamau. And remember to keep it Elimu TV, where you watch
and learn.